Alright, so let's get started. Today we're very happy to have visiting us Mark Lotensberger from MIT. Mark got his PhD in 2009 at the University of Munich and MPA in Garching, working with Simon White and others there. Then he moved on to be an ITC fellow at the CFA, and then later a Hubble fellow. And I think he joined the faculty at MIT in 2014 or so.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
So now he's going to tell us about large-scale simulations.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot, and thanks a lot for the invitation. It's actually been a while since I've been here, I think 3 or 4 years ago, so I'm glad to be back. So I will be talking about cosmological simulations, specifically hydrodynamical cosmological simulations. And I will try to give a bit of an overview and also talk obviously a bit about the work that we did and also see where some of the problems are and where the field might be going over the next couple of years. So there are a lot of people involved in this work that I'm going to present, so I can not mention all of them, but I thought I should just mention the main collaborators. And I especially want to emphasize Shai Genel, who is currently a postdoc at Columbia, who really helped a lot over the last couple of years in running these simulations and setting them up. Then obviously Lars Hörnqvist and Volker Springel are also heavily involved. And I also want to emphasize three people who are now at MIT. So there's Federico Marinacci, who was a postdoc in Heidelberg in Volker Springel's group before, and Paul Torrey, who worked with Lars Hörnqvist before. And Ryan McKinn is a graduate student at MIT at the moment. So before I start, I just want to give a general overview of what we actually try to do. So this will be very low level, but I thought it's good to set the stage. So what we essentially try to do is we want to explain how these kind of objects form, or this is just a specific example, so this is M31. So the idea is that we think we have a pretty good understanding of how the universe evolves. We know the composition of the universe reliably well. We know the initial conditions, something like 400,000 years after the Big Bang, reasonably well. And we know the laws of physics to some degree reasonably well. So the hope is if we put all this together, we should be able to form galaxies like those with computer simulations. Of course, this is not the only type of galaxies. There are more. So we can, in a very, very simplistic way, classify this in elliptical galaxies, in spiral galaxies, where you have unbarred and spiral galaxies in this Hubble tuning fork. And then one question is, what distinguishes the formation channel of these spiral or disk galaxies from these elliptical galaxies? So you can already by eye see that not only the morphology is different, but also the colors are different. So those are more reddish, those are bluer. And we want to see whether we can understand this and whether we can come up with a model that actually reproduces all these features of these galaxies. So the general framework within which we work is the Lambda CDM framework, coupled with a Big Bang and an inflationary phase. So that's very well known to you. So you have the Big Bang, then this brief phase of inflationary phase. Then we think something like 400 million years after the Big Bang, the first stars should have formed, so more or less. And then the interesting part also begins here, when then the first galaxies form a billion years after the Big Bang, and then time goes on, and you build up this whole variety of galaxies and structures going from dwarf galaxies to clusters. And the question is, again, how does this all come into existence? So can we understand this from kind of first principle? So as I said, we also have now amazingly good data about the kind of what we call the initial conditions, so observations of the cosmic microwave background. So there was this enormous progress going from the COBE to WMAP and to the Planck mission. And so this allows us to specify the initial conditions very well, but also to know the composition of the universe extremely well. So this is just these are just some rough numbers. So these are not the exact numbers from Planck, the most recent, but just to just to give you an idea. So we have also this Lambda CDM framework, where a large fraction of the energy density is in dark energy, which is roughly the 70%, and then we have significant fraction in dark matter and only a tiny bit of standard model particles, so standard model of particle physics. So dark energy, as you all know, is a pretty complex and complicated problem because we have at the moment no really working idea what it could be. The situation for dark matter is a bit different, so there are a couple of leading candidates for the dark matter particles. One possible candidate is a neutralino particle, which is the lightest supersymmetric particle in the supersymmetric extension of particle physics. So here you have, for every standard model particle, you have a supersymmetric partner. So that could be a neutralino, for example. Another possibility is that you have dark matter, which is made up of axions. So the axion was proposed a couple of decades ago as a solution to the strong CP problem in quantum chromodynamics. So that would also be a dark matter particle. And if you go in the particle physics literature, you will realize there are tons of other particles. So there are all kinds of models around. The only problem with all these candidates is that we haven't yet detected any particle from these roughly 25%. So there are, over the last couple of decades, also more than 20 or 30 or maybe even more such experiments going on, searching both for axions and also for WIMP-like dark matter. But there has been so far no definite detection. So that's still an outstanding problem, but at least we have a rough idea what this could be in principle. So what we then want to do with these initial conditions and the composition of the universe and the laws of nature, we want to come up with a predictive theory of galaxy formation. So that means we want to be able to write down a model which is able to explain a certain amount of the observational data and at the same time make some predictions. So ideally, what we typically do, for example, at the moment is you come up with a model which reproduces a lot of the redshift zero data, and then you make predictions for the high redshift universe, which at the moment can also be probed. So, and this is how we have this kind of cycle where we come up with a model, we compare to observations, we refine the model, and so on and so forth. So this is how we try to make progress, essentially. So the first thing I want to talk about after this brief introduction are what we call dark matter-only simulations or n-body simulations. So I will only spend 5 minutes on that. This is just to give you a basic idea what people have done in this field over the last, I think, 30 or 40 years and where we stand now. So the basic idea here is if you look at the energy density of the universe, something like 95% are just dark in the form of dark energy and dark matter. So in zeroth order, you can just forget about the baryons, and you only simulate the dark matter and the dark energy. And you look how structure formation goes on in this kind of dark matter-only universe. And these simulations were, as I said, already done in the 70s, and a lot of them were done in the 80s. And they were very important kind of to rule out, for example, hot dark matter or neutrino-dominated universes, and kind of were essential to establish the cold dark matter paradigm. And so I just want to show you some recent simulations. So this is a movie, it will be visible in a few more minutes, which I showed already many, many times. So this is a very famous movie now by Volker Springel that he made already in 2008, based on on the so-called Aquarius simulation. So what you see here is the dark matter distribution and the time evolution, and at the same time you rotate around it. So time is running here, redshift is running over there. And this particular simulation will form a Milky Way-like halo, so that means it will be a dark matter halo with a mass of the order of 10 to the 12 solar masses. So that's more or less the mass that we expect for our own Milky Way halo. So this does not include any baryons, it's really only dark matter and, of course, indirectly dark energy. So what you can see here is this very filamentary structure of the cosmic web that people have found already many, many, many years earlier. But at the same time, you also see that lots of small structures, small subhalos, fall into this more massive structure that forms at the center, which is the main halo, which initially, at the end of the 90s, gave rise to the so-called missing satellite problem. Because if you look at all these subhalos, obviously not all these subhalos can host a visible satellite, because this number is just much larger than what we observe. So people were concerned about this, something like 15 or 20 years ago. Nowadays, it's kind of realized that if you take into account all the physics that goes into star formation, that actually this problem doesn't exist, because many of these subhalos are not able to form stars efficiently enough, so they will just remain dark. And only the more massive ones actually will form satellites. And if you do the numbers in detail, you get actually pretty good agreement with the Milky Way-like satellite counts. So that's essentially where we stand in simulating Milky Way-like halos. That's still kind of state of the art. So I will stop this here. The only problem with these simulations is, as I said, they miss essentially the galaxies. So I just put this here by hand. So this is just to give you the scale. So this whole thing here is the dark matter halo, which is pretty large compared to the galaxy, which is actually at the center, and where you actually have the gas and the stars. You can not only look at these small scales where you simulate individual halos, but obviously you can also look at large-scale statistics. And historically, these were also the first simulations that were done. And here's also kind of state-of-the-art example from Mike Boyle and Kolchin's simulation from 2009. So what you see here is on larger scales, so this is something like 100 megaparsec across the distribution of dark matter. And again, you see this very filamentary structure, and this is here zoomed in on one of the more massive, or probably the most massive object or halo in this simulation. The nice thing that you can then also do, besides making a nice picture, is looking very qualitatively or quantitatively at these simulations. So this is what we call a halo mass function here. So it shows you essentially as a function of halo mass, the number density of halos. And this is shown here for two redshift, redshift 6.2 and redshift 0. And one thing that you can clearly see is that structure formation forms first these smaller objects, because if you look at that curve, you have just no massive objects here. Those form only later, and that is kind of an imprint of hierarchical structure formation within Lambda CDM. So that's just the prediction of the model.
Why are the error bars larger on the Millennium? Not on Millennium 2, but opposed to the Millennium.
You mean here, for example, the blue versus the red? Well, this is simply because the Millennium volume was just significantly larger. It's a 500 megaparsec box, whereas Millennium 2 is just 100. This is also why they are pasted together like this here. You know, essentially, the Millennium 2 was ideally for this mass scale, whereas the Millennium 1 could also probe more massive structures. OK, then you can even go to larger scales. So this is what many people do these days, especially for these large surveys like BOSS and so on. So that you run very large boxes, something like 3 gigaparsecs or even more. And then also the particle numbers go up and up. So this is now from 2012, a paper from Raul Angulo with a particle number of 300 billion particles. And you can see this is really already a pretty enormous scale. And you can also, in these simulations, then find a very large number of halos. This is something like 700 billion halos at redshift zero. So the point that I want to make here is that these kind of simulations are extremely mature now. So the only problem that you have is putting the particles on the machine, which is not so trivial, and having pretty efficient gravity calculation. And then you can, you know, you can do this essentially to larger and larger scales with more and more particles. Unfortunately, if you want to compare these simulations then to observations, you have to have one method how you map halos to galaxies, because the simulation doesn't tell you what kind of galaxy forms at the center and also doesn't tell you what kind of galaxy. So you have to have some method how to map this. And nowadays, kind of the ideal way to do this is by including the baryons in the simulation, which is then called hydrodynamical simulation. So it's called hydrodynamical because the largest fraction of the baryons are just in the gas phase. So you solve essentially, in addition to the dark matter dynamics and the dark energy dynamics, you solve the inviscid Euler equations, and then predict how the gas is moving and how the gas collapses into halos. And that essentially then allows you at the end of the day to predict what kind of galaxies form at the centers. And I will spend the rest of my talk actually on these kind of simulations. And the reason why we need them is that if you have a dark matter only simulation, you cannot simply map this to a galaxy population. And the easiest way to see this is if you look at the halo mass function or the stellar mass function. So this is a schematic plot. So the x-axis shows you here for this yellow or brown line, shows you the halo mass function. And in black, it's the observed stellar mass function. And you can clearly see that these two lines are not just scaled versions of each other. Yeah, so there's something going on here at this massive end, and there's something going on at the faint end. And the thing that is actually going on, so people have pointed this out already, again, many years ago, or decades ago, partially, is what we call feedback. So for example, here, for small galaxies or small halos, the potential well is not very deep. So if you have energetic processes in your galaxy, like, for example, supernova feedback, or other processes that might be associated with stellar evolution, they might inject energy in the galaxy, and by this they might blow out gas or heat up gas or steer turbulence in the gas, which actually prevents star formation. So you can, in these systems, prevent star formation essentially through a large degree by stellar feedback. Here at the massive end, this doesn't work so well anymore because the halos are so massive that the energetics don't work out anymore, so the potential there is rather deep. So it's not so easy to suppress star formation. But there are other processes here. For example, in these galaxies, you typically have also pretty massive, supermassive black holes, and they are associated then with AGN feedback. And AGN feedback, although this is not yet fully settled, but that's kind of the leading idea, that AGN feedback can then substantially suppress star formation in these massive systems. And if you take both, you are then able to take the halo mass function and kind of bend it over in this galaxy stellar mass function. So that's the current idea, how you go from this dark matter only universe to real galaxy population by including these processes. Because if you don't do it, you will just not get this stellar mass function here right. Now, to do these kind of simulations, these hydrodynamical simulations, it's not sufficient just to follow the gas dynamics, because you can imagine if gas is falling into a halo through gravity, it can also be heated and cooled by, for example, atomic or molecular processes, and at some point it will reach densities that actually form stars. And once it forms stars, the stars will evolve. At some point the stars will die, so they will die as supernova, for example, if they are massive enough. And then they will inject, during this process, energy in the gas. At the same time, you might form black holes, and so on and so forth. So you have to include a long list of actually physical processes if you want to do this, this galaxy formation, or if you want to perform these galaxy formation simulations in this hydrodynamical framework. And that is, at the moment, the main challenge, how to do this. And, you know, it depends on which scales you are interested in. It depends on, you know, the numerics, how you put this in. So it's a very difficult problem at the moment. Another problem that we have with these simulations is just the enormous scale that we have to cover, especially with these large-scale simulations. So this is a little moving showing you one of our recent simulations where we here zoom in into the dark matter distribution. So the scale is here running on the left. And the movie is zooming in on one particular halo, which is a bit more massive than a Milky Way-like halo. And at some point, the movie will switch actually to the stellar light distribution. So this simulation is a hydrodynamic simulation, so it includes also gas and stars and so on. It's just at the moment only showing dark matter. And now it switches to the stellar light. So these are SDSS composite images of the stellar light. And you see that the scale of this galaxy, which is actually, you know, calculated in the simulation, is pretty small compared to the scales that you have to resolve on large scales. And, you know, even on these scales, since we want to know also some of the properties of the galaxies, you have to have a lot of resolution elements to resolve these galaxies reasonably well. So what this typically means, that the dynamic range of the simulations that we need is something of the order of 10 to the 6 or 10 to the 7. And, you know, that is then also pretty difficult to model this numerically. And this means actually to run these simulations, you have to have a lot of resolution elements. So that means a lot of, for example, simulation particles or a lot of cells within which you with which you solve the hydrodynamical equations. And this is kind of summarized in this plot that is in Scheigenell's paper. So what this shows is, as a function of time, the number of resolution elements in different kinds of simulation. So the dotted line here is the n-body trend. And there are no simulations here included. It's only the general trend here shown by this best fit exponential. And nowadays, you actually have, you can run n-body simulations with trillions of particles. So that's kind of the state of the art. The solid line is the same. So here we did the same exercise as for the n-body results, and especially showing some of the, you know, just a selected set of simulations. And we include here only simulations which actually reach redshift zero. And you can see there's a variety of numerical schemes actually used. So you can solve the Euler equations actually in different ways. So there are three leading schemes at the moment. There's this SPH, so smooth particle hydrodynamics, where you discretize the gas in terms of mass. Then there's something called AMR, which is adaptive mesh refinement, where you discretize the mesh, where you discretize the volume, essentially. And more recently, there were lots of simulations with what's now called moving mesh, where you have a finite volume scheme, but the mesh is essentially allowed to move. And so it's not fixed as in the AMR calculations. So these are the three schemes. And you can see that initially the field was completely dominated by these SPH simulations. Then now we got also AMR simulations. And actually, the biggest simulations that we recently did is one of these moving mesh calculations, which was published last year. Another thing you can see is also that the physics that is included got also more complex. So this is a very simple distinction here that we made. So we either say it's including only stellar feedback or stellar feedback and black hole feedback. And if you look at this trend, then most of the simulations also include now some form of black hole feedback. And it's kind of interesting that actually, and this is also where the talk title came from, that you have this peak now, that there are a lot of these big hydrodynamical simulations which came out this and last year. So these simulations have actually now reached a state where you can really sample large fields or large scales with pretty good resolution to make detailed statistical statements about the galaxy population. So I just want to show you a few examples of these simulations which came out either this year or last year. So the first simulation I want to talk about briefly or just present is this Eagle simulation. So that's a simulation that was actually done in Europe by the Virgo Consortium. And it was led by Joop Schei. And this simulation, so here's the simulation data. So they simulated a 100 megaparsec cube, essentially, with this resolution. So those of you who are not too familiar with these numbers, actually, if you would go back a couple of years in the literature, then the typical resolution that we had there was 2 times 512 cube or so. So there's really an enormous jump in resolution, which came up over the last couple of years. M-gas is the resolution of the gas particles and essentially also the star particles. So each star particle in these simulations has this mass, which obviously means it's not an individual star, but it's kind of a collection of stars sampled by some IMF. Epsilon here is the softening scale. So that's the scale below which you cannot resolve spatial scales anymore. And Z final is the redshift at which the simulation was stopped. So this simulation was actually stopped at redshift 0. And so it's a pretty impressive calculation. And also, if you look at it in detail, it makes very detailed predictions about the galaxy population. And many of those agree extremely well with observations. Another example is the blue tide simulation. So this came out, I think, 2 or 3 weeks ago from Yu Feng in Berkeley. So this simulation has kind of a slightly different scope. So first of all, the simulation volume is significantly larger. The particle number is also significantly larger. But then the stopping redshift is just 8, so which means this simulation is ideally suited for these high redshift studies. So the reason why this is not 0 is simply because you just cannot run this to 0. This is far too expensive. Actually, running the simulation from redshift 8 to 7 would require the same time as running it from the starting redshift to redshift 8, and then it gets super expensive if you go to lower redshift because the clustering just keeps going. But nevertheless, it's ideal for high redshift studies, and that's also the main purpose of the papers that they put out. Another simulation is the simulation we did last year. So this is this illustrious simulation, which, if you look at the number, looks pretty close to the Eagle simulation. So it's only a bit larger. The gas mass is a bit smaller, but essentially it's very similar. The major difference is that the numerical scheme is completely different. So this Eagle simulation used this smooth particle hydrodynamics, and this is a moving mesh calculation. But besides that, it's rather similar. And so what you see on this kind of poster here, so we tried to showcase some things that you can do in the simulation. So what it shows here in the back is the dark matter density distribution. Then here in this insert, you see the annihilation signal that's predicted for some cluster. For the cluster, you also see the X-ray emission, the SCY signal, and some metal distribution. You can also now look at SDSS images of the galaxies. So there's the central galaxy of the cluster looks like this. So it's just some elliptical galaxy. And then there's one disk or spiral galaxy taken from the field, which you can see here. And in the lower part here, you see the gas density and temperature, entropy, and velocity. So that's just to give you a basic idea what is included in these simulations. To show this a bit more in 3D, so this is a movie which shows, I don't know whether you can, not sure whether you can see this, but it's actually a cube which is rotating. So on the left you see dark matter, on the right, that's much better. So on the left is dark matter, on the right is gas temperature, and then what happens is the movie actually builds up the full simulation distribution at redshift zero from bottom to top. So this is actually going just to see the structures. And you can pretty nicely see here the cosmic web again. And again, this is 100 megaparsec here, the cube. And on the right in the gas, you see, especially for the more massive halos, you see clearly the hot gas, which is heated up first to the real temperature, and then it's further heated up also by AGN feedback, especially radio mode feedback, which is included in the simulation. So that's just to give you some idea how this looks in 3D. Now, obviously, one obvious question to ask is how well do these simulations agree with observations, and how well do they agree among each other? So I showed you in this plot before, where I showed the simulation size or resolution elements versus time, that there are not many simulations today around. And the question is, do they all agree? And if they agree, do they also agree with observations? And what you see here is actually some examples of galaxies that were produced by this illustrious simulation, and they are arranged along the Hubble tuning fork, more or less. So you have some ellipticals here, some irregulars here, and some disk galaxies. And if you just look at them by eye, it's actually now very difficult to distinguish those from real galaxies. And if you look at the Eagle simulation, so there's a slightly different color scheme here, but overall they also get many of the morphologies of the galaxies right. And also if you look at the morphologies more quantitatively, like the ratio of ellipticals over spiral galaxies as a function of stellar mass, for example, this agrees reasonably well also with observations. More quantitatively, you can also look at the star formation rate density. So this is shown here, star formation rate density as a function of redshift. And you should only look here at this blue solid line, which is from the blue tides simulation. So this is the simulation which stopped at redshift 8. So this is why the blue line doesn't go below. And then this gray dashed line, which is the illustrious simulation. And you can also see that there's extremely good agreement. And you know, these are some completely different simulations which were run by completely independent groups. And it's pretty amazing that, with all these uncertainties, numerical schemes, feedback modeling, and so on, you get here reasonable agreement. And even better, also the agreement, there are not many observations around at this redshift, but there's at least some reasonable agreement also with the observations. So in general, I think this is pretty encouraging. More quantitatively, you can also look at, for example, UV luminosity functions. And this is, again, a plot from Yu Feng. And if you just focus on redshift 9, for example, and look here again at the illustrious data symbols, and you compare to the red or blue line, which is the blue tides, then there's also pretty good agreement. And in general, if you compare again here, for example, to observations, you also get a pretty good agreement at these very high redshifts. If you look at lower redshifts, so this is shown in this plot, this is the galaxy stellar mass function at redshift 0, where there's some SDSS data shown here with these gray symbols. And then some older and some more recent simulations are overplotted. It's a lot of lines here, but the general bottom line is that also there, the agreement is not perfect, as you can clearly see, but it's much better than what we had 5 or 10 years ago. And also the different simulations get actually the shape reasonably right. And especially the Eagle collaboration, if you look at this line here, it's actually pretty close to the observations. Yeah.
So the blue tides is a bigger box, but a lot more particles are.
Yeah.
So the mass resolution, though, it looks like it's similar.
Well, the mass resolution. Let me just check the numbers again. So this is what we have, and also what Eagle has, 10 to the 6. And yeah, it's approximately the same, yeah. The spatial scale is different, but yeah, the mass resolution is more or less the same.
What are the differences in the dominant feedback in terms of limiting the rate of star formation at CO8 versus CO2?
Say again, sorry.
Does the dominant feedback mechanism at CO8 in terms of limiting the rate of star formation differ from that at CO2?
Yeah, so if you look, for example, at, just let me show this again, at this plot here, where I show the cosmic star formation rate density, what mainly limits star formation here is actually stellar feedback. So there's no AGN feedback at play here. This is really pure stellar feedback. And the reason why it agrees, although it's surprising, but part of the reason is also that the, if you read the paper of the Blue Tides group more in detail, that the feedback model was actually set up in terms of their parameters rather similar to the illustrious model. So it's still, of course, a slightly different implementation, but the feedback parameters are rather similar. So, but yeah, it's only stellar feedback that plays a role at these redshifts. Yes, we use that, but then we modified the mass loading and the velocity of the winds, which are now depending on the local velocity dispersion of dark matter.
Right. But yeah. There's the pressure support.
Yes.
And then in addition, you've got the winds.
Yeah. So I think the basic ISM model in Blue Tides and in illustrious is the same. It's
so they use the same.
Yeah. It's the same.
So they both use that pressurization.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
And presumably they got the mass loading is pretty high.
The
wind rate to the starting machine.
Yeah, it's actually hundreds at the low mass end. Yeah, it's extremely high. Yeah.
So they just throw out 100 times as much gas as you turn into stars.
Yeah.
You have to do that to get those relations.
And basically energy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, that they just put in the parameters. So like the mass loading, I guess. Well, your scaling changes.
No, ours doesn't scale. So we have all the way from low mass to high mass energy.
Well, over G-squared.
Yeah, yeah. So there are other groups that have a break. Yeah. Okay. So just let me summarize this. So in principle, I think it looks pretty promising, because it could also be that first of all that we get all very different results, and secondly that that we don't agree with the data.
What's the hydro scheme for Blue Tides?
It's some improved pressure SPH. Yeah. It's not traditional SPH, but with more recent fixes. Okay. So after showing you that I think there's generally good agreement, I just want to focus on a few more of the illustrious results. So what I show here is again a plot from Scheigenel's paper. And it shows the galaxy stellar mass function now not only at redshift 0, but also at higher redshift, and actually going back to redshift 7, and compares this to data that is available. Obviously, the data at these high redshifts is not super reliable, but nevertheless, what you see is actually that the general trends are kind of okay in terms of that the simulation reproduces more or less the observations. Obviously, we don't get a perfect match, but it's kind of good enough to think that the model at least captures most of the relevant processes for galaxy formation. So that is kind of the best that you can get. If you look at the Eagle papers, their agreement might be slightly better, but it's you will never be able to fit these points exactly. And I should also point out it's probably not even desirable to get the redshift 7 observations right, because there might be a lot of systematics involved. So it's just important that we get the trends more or less right. And that works reasonably well with these simulations. Another thing you can check is you can compare to what is known as abundance matching. So here the idea is that if you run an n-body simulation, so dark matter only simulation, and if you rank the halos by mass, and then you look at some galaxy survey like STSS, and you rank them by stellar mass, then you can make kind of a correspondence. What is the mass, the stellar mass of a halo of a given halo mass? And if you do this exercise, you come up with a plot like that, where on the x-axis you see halo mass, and on the y-axis you see more or less stellar mass here. And these three curves here, Mostar, Baruzi, and Kravtsov, are these abundance matching results where people combined n-body with observations, and they come up with some curves which look like that. For example, the sine curve, so it's very low at low mass end, it's kind of high at about 10 to the 12 solar masses, and then it goes down again. So the first thing that what this tells you is actually that star formation is most efficient at this mass scale. Yeah, because you don't form many stars here, you don't form many stars here, but at that mass scale it's pretty efficient. And this is a general prediction of all these abundance matching techniques. The peak might shift a bit, but generally speaking it's always around that mass scale. And now the question is, can the simulation actually reproduce this? And so the simulation curves are here shown. They're two versions shown, one in black and red, so the details are not so important here. But the general trend is that we also peak at around the right scale, and we also suppress star formation significantly towards the massive end and towards the low mass end. And although if you look at the plot, it doesn't look like such a great agreement, you should also realize that this is actually a linear scale here. So we are talking about percent level differences. So it's at least on this scale here. So it's not so bad. So in general, we can reproduce this reasonably well. And the Eagle people can also reproduce this. So in general, it looks like that we really capture most of the galaxy formation processes, especially the feedback at the faint and the massive end. However, I would like to point out that all the feedback processes that we include in these simulations, both the stellar feedback and the HAN feedback, are extremely simplistic. I will come back to this towards the end of my talk. So, for example, we don't resolve star formation. You know, star formation is even an open problem. The stellar feedback is also modeled in a very ad hoc way, and the radio mode feedback of HAN is also very ad hoc. But nevertheless, these simplistic feedback models seem to get many things right.
What are your predictions for how the variant of dark matter ratio of the halo varies between bolus-dominated galaxies, which is a larger black hole, and disk-dominated galaxies? You know, in the mass range where there is some significant overlap.
I haven't checked this myself. I don't know whether we looked at that already in detail. So there are a couple of people working on that, but yeah, I don't have an answer for this at the moment. So my point is really that the models are very simple. So you should, whenever you see any of these results, you should appreciate that the models are really very simple. There's a lot of work that needs to be done in coming up with more detailed models. But nevertheless, as I said, the prediction is that they get many things right. Another field where these simulations are extremely useful is looking at the impact of large-scale environment on galaxy formation. So this is shown here on this slide. So let's first focus on this left here, on the left panel here. So what you see here is actually a SDSS result from Peng et al., who presented this in 2010. So you see here for galaxies plotted the stellar mass, and here the galaxy overdensity, so they have some measure of the environment in terms of the overdensity of galaxies. And then they plot what they call the red fraction. So this is essentially if you make in G minus R color a cut somehow through the Green Valley, then you can say a galaxy is more red or is more blue. And then you just calculate the fractions in each of these bins here, and you get a plot like that. And what the plot tells you is that if you go along the x-axis, you essentially go from a low red fraction to a high red fraction. And the same happens if you go along the y-axis, a low red fraction and a high red fraction. So the reason for this is, or it's thought to be, that along this axis, you get more and more massive systems. And at some point, systems will be affected by AGN feedback. And AGN feedback will then be more efficient in these systems and will shut off star formation. If you have no newly forming stars, you have an old stellar population, it will age, and the stars will, in general, become redder. So this is what people think what's happening here. In the y direction, it's a different process. So there, if you think, for example, about galaxies in clusters, so satellite galaxies in clusters, then in this environment, you might have hydrodynamical processes like ram pressure stripping or tidal forces and so on, which might actually also remove then gas from the galaxies. So there's no new material to form stars. And again, you end up with an old stellar population, which becomes redder. So this is why this axis also becomes redder. And at the end of the day, you get this kind of pattern. Now you can make the same exercise in the simulation. So this is shown here. Again, the x-axis is stellar mass. The y-axis is overdensity. And again, we calculated some red fraction here. And the first thing you see is that the general trend looks OK. You know, you see something more bluish here, something redder here. So qualitatively, we reproduce this. The reason why it's not reproduced quantitatively, there are a couple of reasons. First of all, there's, for example, no dust correction here. So this is just taking the intrinsic colors for galaxies. That is probably not the main reason why it doesn't agree. The main reason actually is that many of our galaxies don't have exactly the right colors. The reason for that is not yet fully clear. It might have to do that our feedback models are not as perfect as we think. Or that, for example, the AGN feedback quenches star formation at the wrong mass scale. or processes like that. So it's definitely qualitatively, quantitatively not in perfect agreement, but qualitatively we get this trend right. And so that's definitely also something where especially these large scale simulations. It's redshift zero. Yeah. So it's definitely something where you can only use this large-scale simulation. So you cannot simulate an individual galaxy at very high resolution and make these kind of plots. So you really need the large-scale environment and a large statistics also. So I think this is pretty promising to look at these kind of things also in the future. Another more qualitative thing that you can do, which I think will also become more important over the next couple of years, is looking at mock images of galaxies. So what you can do, this is just an example showing this, you can take, for example, an image from the Hubble Ultra Deep Field from HST, which is shown here on the left, and you take the simulation data and you kind of make a mock Hubble Ultra Deep Field, which is shown here, taking all the filters and maybe even add noise and, just make it as similar as possible, and then just try to compare this. So, I put here this white line, but if I would remove the white line, this you have to believe me, it will be hard to tell the difference by eye here. And also statistically, the images are very similar. So what this allows you, I think, as I said, this is very promising for the future, is to make a lot of mock observations and then use the same pipelines that actually observers use to post-process your data and then, analyze the simulation data and the observational data in more or less the same way to make a more detailed comparison. So it might also help to understand your better systematic errors and noise errors in any observation. So I think this is really a pretty promising route. And Greg Snyder and Paul Torrey are actually working a lot on this. Another thing that will become more and more important over the next couple of years is actually understanding the dark matter baryon back reaction. So what I mean by what's meant by this is that if you have these energetic processes happening in the baryons, for example, supernova feedback or AGN feedback, you can imagine that if you heat a lot of gas and it will expand, then gravity will also pull some of the dark matter with the gas along. And so you will not only change the distribution of baryons, but also of dark matter. So in the total matter distribution or the, will actually change significantly. So why is that important? Well, if you look at upcoming or available weak lensing surveys, then what they try to do is they measure in a certain K range the power spectrum to pretty high precision. And the idea is then by these measurements actually to constrain cosmology. Yeah, so you come up with a model, a cosmological model with some parameters which predicts a certain P of K. You compare to your weak lensing survey and you try to constrain the model. So the only problem with that is that actually the weak lensing scale, and this is shown in this plot here, so this plot shows power spectra, so as a function of k, you see here the non-dimensional power spectrum, delta square, and you should only focus on this bluish line and the black line here, so this is just showing the power spectra. And in the bottom panel, we show the ratio between the simulation which includes baryons and the simulation which does not include baryons, so which is a dark matter only simulation, and this ratio is shown here with this black line. Yeah, and what you can see here is in the regime where weak lensing surveys are very sensitive, you actually get pretty substantial deviations from the dark matter only prediction if you include the baryons. So what this means is that AGN feedback, for example, or other processes in the baryons will actually significantly or can significantly alter your power spectrum to a degree that it will affect the interpretation of weak lensing surveys. So I think over the next years this will become more and more of a problem, because it's not that this is now a definite prediction, because if you would change, for example, the AGN or in general the feedback model, the curve might look different, and then it's not fully clear which is the right feedback parameterization, and then it's also not clear what is the right effect that we expect there, and then it's not clear how to interpret the data. So this is at the moment still a pretty big problem. But also here you would need kind of more of these simulations and with a better physical understanding of the feedback implementations.
So if I think of that as like a halo model, it would be as though you had contraction. Going from the blue line to the black line, small scales, you get more power.
Yes, that is happening on these scales. On these scales, it can be different, because what happens here is if you have the more energetic AGN feedback, it blows out gas from the halos. So you actually got, I will show this also in a few minutes, you get actually a significant reduction of the baryon fractions in these halos. But again, this is all uncertain with respect to the modeling, how you do the feedback modeling. So you know, that's the big problem. Okay, so speaking about problems of these models, I just want to point out two examples of limitations of galaxy formation models, just to show you that this is not the end of the story, but probably just the beginning, because although the models are pretty successful, there are a lot of caveats and problems in these simulations. And I just will point out two. Of course, there are many more. And one problem is, and Norm already asked about this, which is actually modeling the ISM. So in these simulations, the ISM is modeled in an extremely simplistic way, essentially just as an effective equation of state, where if the gas is denser than a certain value, you will just have a pre-described equation of state just to model the ISM physics, which in these simulations at the moment you cannot resolve because the spatial scales and the mass resolution is just too poor. However, if you take all your computing power and focus it in one galaxy or one halo, a dwarf or a Milky Way galaxy, for example, then you can come up with better or more explicit feedback models. And this is something that Norm and Phil Hopkins worked on. And these models then are more explicit in the sense that they just treat the different physical processes in a more direct way. So it's not as subcrit as the models that we use. And specifically, they include then radiation pressure and a more detailed treatment of supernova feedback and stellar winds and photoionization and also photoelectric heating. So that's all much more elaborate than what we do. The problem here is that it really typically requires pretty high spatial and mass resolution, which we just cannot do at the moment in these large scales. So if you remember, if you require something like 10 or 20 or 50 parsec resolution, our simulations typically have a spatial resolution of 500 or 1,000 parsec. So it's just still far away, so we cannot do this. But the problem is that these explicit models also in many aspects work quite differently from the subcrit models. So this raises then the questions, is it valid to use the subcrit models or is it just completely wrong? Or should we rewrite the subcrit models? You know, it's just unclear at the moment. So the only way to make progress is actually that we try to connect these scales, ideally in the way that we look at these more explicit models and see what kind of predictions they make for slightly larger scales and try to come up with new subcrit models which are inspired by these more explicit treatments. So just to give you an idea what these explicit models predict, so these are plots from a recent paper by Phil Hopkins. So what you see here on the left is again a comparison to these abundance matching results, now comparing models which have a more explicit treatment of the feedback. So the lines here are abundance matching, so these are just two different ways how to show this. So there are different abundance matching relations, and the data points here are actually individual simulations. And one thing you see is that these simulations get this, you know, like amazingly well, or follow amazingly well these relations. So this means if you have this more explicit feedback, which leads, for example, to a self-regulated ISM, you get many of the stellar masses actually right. So this is a very nice prediction. And you know, now we also get this right with the subcrit models. But then there's one very important difference, or a few differences. But one important one is if you look at the star formation history. So this is star formation as a function of redshift. So you should only look at the black curve here and the blue curve here. So the black is actually what these explicit models predict. So you see it's a very bursty star formation history. Now if you compare to the blue, this is the prediction of one of these subcrit models, which is kind of similar to the models we use. And you can see that this is much smoother. So the behavior of star formation history is very different. Although the stellar mass at the end might be comparable, but nevertheless, there's a significant difference. So clearly, these models don't exactly operate in the same way. You know, and this might even have further implications. And I just mentioned this here. If you again look at dark matter baryon interaction, that if you run, for example, a dwarf galaxy with this very bursty feedback model, this model might actually be able to create a very quad profile. in the dark matter distribution, whereas the more smooth model here does not. So clearly there are quantitatively significant differences between the models. And you know, at the moment, as I said, it's not clear whether you should fully trust these subgrid models or you know what you should do about them, because clearly there are some differences if you look at more explicit models.
Exactly the same
mission
conditions, or
what
extension do you trust stochasticity in a single
hail? Those were exactly the same.
Yeah. Yeah. So there's really a significant difference. Yeah. So it's pretty, and actually, there are now a couple of groups who have these more explicit models, and they all predict this very bursty star formation history, which essentially has also to do with the fact that the star formation density threshold is much higher than in these more smooth models. So it's kind of an interesting problem at the moment that you could.
You end up with a different problem type.
Say again?
You end up with a different problem type.
These runs, no. Hmm. We don't have any AGNZ type.
So what type of galaxy is this?
These are all blue star forming galaxies here. Okay. And we do have a few which we didn't plot because they don't have the right physics and they give the wrong answer. We don't have the AGN physics.
So you shouldn't trust the bulge to dissipation, for example?
No, you should not. Well, there's hardly any bulge. It's mostly, as you can see, the stellar mass. This is halo mass.
No. Okay. So yeah, so I just wanted to point this problem out. This is just one problem out of many. Another problem, which happens at a completely different mass scale, is not the modeling of the stellar feedback, but of the AGN feedback. And there are also a lot of problems here. And this is just, again, a plot from Scheigenell. And you should only look at the green solid line and the green symbols here. So what it shows is, as a function of halo mass, here measured in M500 crit, it shows the mass fraction. And if you look at the, and green is the gas mass fraction. And here are some observations. And you can clearly see that this solid line is not in great agreement here with the data points. You know, what this means is that our gas fractions are far too low compared to observations. So the reason where this comes from is that our AGN feedback is actually tuned in a way. So when we were setting up the simulation, it's tuned in a way to produce massive galaxies which have the right stellar mass. So if you have a massive halo, then in this massive halo there will sit a galaxy, and according to abundance matching, we know more or less what kind of stellar mass we expect. And the model was specifically tuned to get these stellar masses right. So this is how this, what we call radio mode AGN feedback, was set up. And then we ran the simulation, and indeed we got the stellar masses right, you know, because we tuned the model like that. But unfortunately, in post-processing, we then found this problem, and the reason why this problem exists is that the radio mode is now so energetic that it kind of quenches star formation by just blowing out a lot of gas of the halos. So you know, you inject a lot of energy from the radio mode feedback to stop star formation, but at the same point, this energy drives away a lot of gas, and then you have just removed too much gas from the halo, such that these gas fractions become too low. So it's inconsistent. So this means with this radio mode, it's just difficult to get the gas fractions right and at the same time get the stellar masses right. It's just intrinsically difficult in this model. So what this means is, the model is probably too simplistic, so you can think about some variations of the model. For example, this radio mode model that we have is very bursty, so what this means is it waits a long time until it actually injects the energy, so the black hole is accreting a lot of mass, and at some point it will just, with a certain efficiency, inject the energy in the halo, and this happens, you know, very infrequent in the model, but then you inject a lot of energy and you blow out a lot of gas. Now you could make this, you know, a bit more smoother just to heat the halo more frequently. So that might work, although we tried this already a couple of years ago and it's very difficult to get then the stellar masses right, because if you do it very infrequent and you blow away a lot of gas, it's very efficient in quenching. So if you do it more frequent, it's more difficult.
No,
I think you, well, the thing is the radio mode becomes extremely efficient around redshift 1 and below, so that's the main problem with testing this. You really have to, yeah, it's just very expensive. Yeah. So The burstiness could be a way to do it. You could also try not to put this this huge amount of thermal energy in, but to make some more kind of momentum injection. Or you could think of other non-thermal pressure sources like you know, cosmic rays, MHD. But so at the moment, this is still kind of an outstanding problem in the model. In the old model at the moment.
Yeah.
So what happens is you do this kind of bubble model where you know you accumulate the energy and then you put it something like 100 or 50 kpc away from the black hole, which is supposed to mimic you know the jet inflated bubbles. So anyways, at the end of the day, this model might also be too simplistic and one has to work on that. So these were just two examples. So before I conclude, I just want to mention two more things. So first of all, I want to mention that all the illustrious data is now publicly available, so the whole simulation data, and we are actually pretty proud of the fact that it took us less than 1 year to make this available. So from this point on, you can download the data, you can do what you want with it. No one of the illustrious collaboration has to be co-author. You know, you can just write a single author paper on this. And we think we made it pretty easy to handle the data, so you can either download full snapshots, Halo catalogs, or merger trees, or you can work with some web-based API. So it's very different from what is done with this SQL database for the Millennium database. It's much more direct. And so the API and the you know the examples that we provide are all available in you know in IDL Python and MATLAB, and we're also working on some Julia interface. So Julia is a new programming language developed at MIT, which actually has a syntax very similar to MATLAB, but is a factor of 1,000 faster and for many, so it actually gets pretty close to C performance. So everybody who's interested in that should have a look. Yeah, it's exactly like, yeah, you can also have interactive sessions like Python, yeah. Anyway, so I think it's very easy to use the data, and there's also lots of tutorials how to handle it, so everybody interested should have a look at this. And so Dylan Nelson put a paper out beginning of April about the data release. Just two or three more minutes, I want to talk about what comes next. So this is just a few slides, what we are currently working on. So Federico Marinacci at MIT is currently working on looking at large-scale magnetic fields. So this is all super preliminary, so you should not take this too serious here. So what you see here is from two different simulations, a non-radiative simulation and some simulation with illustrious physics, 100 megaparsec box where we put in MHD, and what you see here is actually the strength of the magnetic field. The only thing you see here in this plot is not too surprising, that if you have this non-radiative simulation, which includes no cooling and so on, you get significantly weaker magnetic fields than in the full physics simulation, because there's just more compression and turbulence going on, which amplifies the field here. You can also look at this in more detail, like you can, for the full physics simulation, plot the average magnetic field as a function of halo mass. So this is shown here for redshift 2, 1, 0.5, and 0. The only thing that I want to point out is, well, you get this very nice and also not too surprising relation that the B field gets just more amplified towards the massive halos, and then here you get the saturation effect at something like, I don't know, 50 or 40 micrograms, which is all in pretty good agreement with the observations. Another interesting thing that you can do is you can look at the topology of the magnetic field. So this is shown here. So this is for the topology around, this is essentially a slice through the magnetic field. The color shows the strength of the magnetic field, and these are the field lines. And this is around a halo where you get this very turbulent and you know, tangled structure of the magnetic field. This is in a void region with a filament. Now you see this super preferred direction here, and that is simply a remnant of the seed field. So the seed field was actually put in that direction here. You know, these are ideal MHD simulations, so you have to put a seed field. So we are currently working on an idea where actually the strength of the magnetic field at redshift zero, you know, could either impact galaxy formation in a way that you could come up with new constraints for the magnetic field, for the seed fields, so it's not yet clear whether this works. But what clearly works is that you can actually, in the voids and the filaments, look at the magnetic field, and they always remember the seed configuration. So that might also be something interesting if you want to constrain seed mechanisms. I think for that, it's something like 10 to the minus 13 Gauss co-moving. Yeah. So the thing is, for especially if you're interested in the magnetic fields in collapsed structures, it actually doesn't matter much, because as soon as the amplification goes on, it's kind of exponential, and then it saturates. So here you will actually, the magnetic field loses every memory of the initial conditions in the collapsed structures. But here it's just more interesting because you have some imprint. So that's the interesting region. And the last thing that I want to mention is that Ryan McKinnon, so the graduate student, he works on a very, very simple model of dust formation in galactic halos. So this is just an example where we show six different galactic halos, so face on, edge on, and we show the dust to metal ratio. So this model is really extremely simple. So what we do is we look at production mechanism of dust, and then we have grain growth in the ISM and grain destruction due to supernova shocks, but all in a very simplistic way. So the reason why we worked with this very simple model, or why I actually show this, is that even with this very simple model, you get actually a pretty good agreement with many scaling relations that were recently found for dust. So this is just one example. This is a comparison to the Herschel reference survey, where I show where Ryan shows the gas fraction versus dust mass, and then in gray it's observations, and then you see some simulations here, and you see a pretty good agreement. The same is true if you look at the radial profile, so radius versus dust surface density. So these are just the different lines here, different simulations, and the symbols here are M31 measurements. And again, this is not too far off. And the dashed line, which is hard to read here, is kind of from a stacked analysis of the SDSS data. So this trend here, which is also kind of, you know, not too far off from the simulations. And the last slide that I want to show is the long-term outlook. So we are currently working with Lars and with Volker, and actually Annalisa Pilipic at Harvard is leading this, on a follow-up of Illustrious, which will be 8 times larger than Illustrious in volume, and also have 8 times the number of particles, so something close to, I think, 90 billion simulation particles. And so Volker has implemented some improvements in the numerical method, so the code got more efficient, so it's also now fully hybrid parallelized, and so there were many improvements in terms of the performance. In terms of physics, we will run this with MHD with some new AGN feedback model that we are currently working on to get rid of these problems that I just showed you. The stellar feedback and the ISM physics will stay more or less the same, because we just don't have better resolution at the moment. So this is pretty expensive, and we got something like 90 million CPU hours on Hornet, which is a machine in Stuttgart, so Volker Springer is the PI of that. And we are currently doing tests on Stampede with an Exceed, where we got a 5 million allocation. And so the expectation is that will probably be published in a year or two, but, well, probably 3 years. Not too optimistic that it can be done quickly. So the main reason why we run this is we want to fix some of the problems of Illustrious 1, and then we also want to explore more the massive scales, which we couldn't do because the box was too small. And I think I will stop here. Thanks.
How much do you test your MHD solver with regard to, say, Kerbal spectra?
Yeah, actually the MHD solver that we use is the one that's implemented by Rüdiger Packmore, which is at the moment the Powell scheme. So what he did, I think the best test he did is except for the idealized test, which all worked reasonably well, he also tested MRI runs and got the growth rate actually right there in these runs. So that's the most stringent test that we did so far. So he wrote a couple of papers with other test problems.
Dominant growth wavelength, right?
Yeah.
So that's an important test, but if you're interested in the turbulent amplification of magnetic fields, presumably you over a range of scales within your halos.
Yes, so we haven't yet done, for the amplification of B fields and halos, it's very difficult to test, obviously, because we have no analytic solution. So the best test that we can do at the moment is that Philip Moss, who's a student of Lars, has implemented a constraint transport in a repo. So we just started 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago to do some, these runs that Federico is running, these runs uh, to to run them also with constrained transport. But I don't have any results so far. So the hope is, of course, that it doesn't disagree strongly. But I have.
But of course, there's a long history with spectral methods. Like
yes. Yeah.
NHD spectra and so
on. Yeah. Yeah. So I think these were all the tests that we did, and I'm especially curious to see this with constrained transport, because you know, this is especially if you turn the feedback on, it's a very complicated environment with a lot of shearing flows and turbulence, so that will be very tough. So yeah, Philip Moss, he had a paper on that already, on the basic idea how to do this on a moving mesh, and yeah, now we will just run the simulations.
Okay, so I think we will continue this over cookies. So we're having dinner. Mark for dinner time, so please let me know. I'll send an email out, but let me know if you'd like to join. And Mark will be around to the end of the day, so on the chat with him, we'll catch up.
Okay, thanks.